Welcome everyone to this second of our webinars on our decarbonization journey here in Maersk. My name is Morten Christiansen and I'm head of the decarbonization team. It's a great pleasure to welcome you here. A couple of weeks ago we had our first webinar where we talked about the customer angle and the more the societal angle. We called it the momentum. We will also be hosting some webinars where we talk about the actual vessels that we will put on the sea and also a webinar around the fuels that we will use. But today we talk about the fourth pillar of the journey, namely the regulatory framework. So we have named this session Fueling Politics, because politicians and regulators will play a very, very important role in the acceleration and the whole transition of the decarbonization of shipping and logistics. So in each of these webinars, I have with me some colleagues from A.P. Moller Maersk, and this time, given the topic, I have two colleagues here. I have Ingrid Andersen, who is from the decarbonization team. So Ingrid is responsible for our target setting and the whole life cycle assessment of the different fuels and ships and so on. And then warm welcome to you, Ingrid. Then I also have Simon. Simon is Director of Regulatory Affairs. So Simon, he spends all his time working on the climate and environmental aspects of the regulatory work. So also a warm welcome to you, Simon. So it is there's a lot going on at the moment in the regulatory space, and I think Simon will have a busy year, certainly some busy months coming up, both on the IMO front and also on the EU front. So maybe Simon, maybe you can kick us off by setting the scene of what is going on at the moment.
Yeah, certainly, and indeed, it will be some very interesting months ahead, and an interesting 2021 when it comes to decarbonization and regulatory affairs. If we start with the UN level and the International Maritime Organization, we have two sets of important meetings this year. We have a meeting in May and June, and another meeting in October, November. If we start with the meeting in May and June, which is just coming up right now. It's going to be a fundamental meeting for the IMO because it will have to close down the discussion on the short-term measures, which are the measures for the existing fleet and the measures that tackle reduction and not really transition. It will have to take a stance on the R&D fund that's being proposed there, and it will also have to start unpacking the difficult discussion on carbon pricing. So that's going to be a complicated set of meeting here in May and June. And if we look at the EU side of things, here we are nearing the man on the moon moment for the European Union. Mid-July, the EU will put forward its Fit for 55 Green Deal package. That package is, of course, going to encompass a lot of different sectors, a lot of different proposals. We will focus on the logistics and shipping aspects, and not least there, of course, the inclusion of maritime into the emission trading system.
Okay. Yeah, so I guess last week concluded that this is really an emergency situation, and we are faced with a crisis. So I think it's great to see that both IMO and the EU are taking some more short-term actions here. But what, Simon, what's your perspective sort of on the more long-term outlook for the decarbonization of greenhouse gases in the industry?
I think we all would have hoped to be a lot further along in the IMO. When it was adopted in 2018, the IMO strategy was ambitious at the time. But we also have to ask ourselves whether it's ambitious enough now. So when we're starting to look at the long-term measures, what we're looking at specifically is, as I mentioned, the R&D fund, which is a global fund with unprecedented amount of money that could go into research and development. We're talking about a $5 billion fund. Then we need to talk about the carbon pricing elements, because without a carbon price adopted at global level, it will be very difficult to push the new fuels into the market. And lastly, we have also to talk about these ambitions level. And the ambition level at IMO was deemed very ambitious in 2018. But right now, we just have a situation whereby things have evolved a lot over the past 3 years. And we have to take a stance and say that they have to go up and they have to be more ambitious. And thankfully, in 2023, there's a revision of the ambition, of the level of ambition, and they can only go one way.
Yeah. I guess that's the perfect segue over to you, Ingrid Marie. So you work on the target setting and the more science, the climate science side of things. And if you look at the the IMO strategy. How does that sort of line up against general climate science and not least the Paris Agreement goals?
Well, the ambition of the IMO is to reduce greenhouse gas emissions from shipping by 50% in 2050. And at the same time, we have the Paris Agreement with the goal of keeping global warming within 1.5 degrees, and climate science telling us that in order to do so, we need to reach net zero emissions by 2050 and basically half them in 2030. So it doesn't really line up. There's really a need to increase the level of ambition in the IMO. In Maersk, we are committed to setting net zero targets in 2050. And we're working on setting ambitious short-term targets for operations that are based on climate science.
Yeah. So you also work on the life cycle aspect of things. And Simon just mentioned that we will see a whole host of regulatory measures coming in soon. So sort of when you're with your life cycle angle on this, what are your reflections on that?
Well, with the emergence of new fuels and in the industry, there's going to be a lot more complexity to the choice of fuels for a ship owner to make. And it's very important that the regulations inform and incentivize the uptake of the right fuels, the fuels that actually have a real potential to reduce greenhouse gas emissions from ship. And in shipping today, we are used to just looking at the CO2 that comes out of the ship when we burn the fuel on board. But in the future, this really has to change, and we have to adopt a more holistic view on our fuels. We need to look at them from a life cycle perspective, or what we call a well-to-wake perspective, considering all aspects of also producing the fuel. And we need to start looking at other greenhouse gases than CO2 as well. Yeah. And the need for doing that is best illustrated by some examples of future fuels and shipping. So we have potential future fuels such as ammonia and hydrogen that are zero carbon fuels that contain no carbon. So when we burn them on our ship, they emit no CO2. But in order to be truly sustainable and to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, they also need to be produced from renewable energy like wind or solar. And today, ammonia and hydrogen is produced from natural gas or fossil feedstocks. So if we consider the life cycle of the fuel, there's really no real reduction. So we solved the problem on board the ship, but we just moved the emissions to the production of the fuel. And similarly with methanol, it's another potential future fuel that contains carbon. So when we burn it, it emits CO2. But that CO2 might be sourced from, or the carbon in the fuel might be sourced from biogenic feedstocks such as wood waste. So the carbon in the fuel is carbon that has been absorbed from the atmosphere. And then when we burn the fuel, it's re-emitted into the atmosphere. So there's no net addition of carbon into the atmosphere from that kind of fuel. But today, methanol is also produced from fossil feedstocks. So it's really essential to include the consideration of the production as well. And then as an example of a fuel that illustrates the need to consider other greenhouse gases than CO2, we have LNG, which is an increasingly popular shipping fuel. It's a fossil fuel, but it contains 25% to 30% less carbon per unit of energy. So when it's used as fuel, it emits less CO2 than if we had used fuel oil. But LNG is essentially methane, and on a 20-year time horizon, methane has a global warming potential that's 86 times higher than of CO2. So it doesn't take a lot of slip in the production or in the combustion on board the ship to completely counteract the CO2 benefits of using LNG.
Yeah. So I guess what you are describing here is an extremely complex situation, right? When you have to choose which path do I go? And it is indeed very, very complex. But I guess what you're also saying is that if you apply, let's say, three simple principles, that everything needs to be based on full life cycle assessments, so well to wake or well to wheel, if we're talking about the land side, that would be one principle. The second principle would be that you have to look at all greenhouse gases. And the third be that you actually both have to look at it from a 100-year perspective, which is what actually is normally done, but also on a 20-year, because we are trying to solve a 2050 problem. And then it doesn't really make sense to have a 100-year decision criteria. So I guess if you know, if And even that will not be easy, but at least then you would have a relatively rigorous framework for actually assessing the different fuels. And you mentioned this methane discussion, and there's a lot of talk about that, and you know, we would actually rather talk about what we do than what we don't. But there's a lot of interest from both customers and investors on our position on this, and I think you're making it clear. But maybe if you can elaborate a little bit on that, both on sort of how much of a problem is methane, but actually also you said that there's methane slippage in the production, which I think is what the oil companies are trying to deal with. And I guess it depends on where you produce and how you produce. But there can actually also be very significant slippage on the vessel itself, depending on the engine you use. And you are actually a naval architect, so you know a few things about engines. So maybe if you could just elaborate on these things, also on the overall methane
situation. Yes. So globally, the methane content in the atmosphere is at an all-time high, and it's rising quite rapidly. And it's contributing to a significant part of global warming, actually. So CO2 is the most important contributor, but methane is also very considerable. And just from shipping, the amount of methane emissions has increased by 150% from 2012 to 2018. And that's even before the big vessels that have recently been put into operation actually started sailing on LNG. So we expect that these emissions of methane from shipping will increase drastically over the years. And that's also due to the fact that different engines have different slip. There's the high pressure two-stroke diesel engine that doesn't emit a lot of methane. The methane slip is quite small, but it's not the most widespread or popular engine to use when you burn LNG. The most popular engine is the low pressure two-stroke engine, and that has a methane slip that's 15 times higher than of a high pressure engine. And a lot of vessels also are equipped with four-stroke engines, like cruise vessels and ferries, and those engines have a slip that's 30 times higher than of a high pressure engine. So there are good engines for burning LNG, but unfortunately not a very big portion of the ships in operation or on order are equipped with these engines.
So you're saying already in 2018, before any mega ship hit the waters, we saw 150% increase. I think CO2 emissions were maybe 6% up or something like that in that period, right? So now that we will see a large order book and installed base of low pressure engines that unfortunately have been chosen, I guess, for cost reasons, we are actually likely to see a significant increase in the methane slip from, or the methane emissions from shipping, and I guess that's our concern in a nutshell, right? I think with the current knowledge, the current science, that just looks to be very, very concerning, and that's why we believe that the right thing to do is to go to a properly carbon, a fuel that can be net zero on a 20-year horizon. That's really where we should use our energy. But let's leave that topic for now, and maybe I'll turn to you again, Simon. So the IMO is it's under the United Nations, so many member states, and of course therefore not so easy to agree on everything, because many member states see different on things. Is it not tempting to just jump on the EU momentum and just go full steam ahead on that, or what is your perspective on that?
It's tempting, yeah, for sure, it's tempting. But if I could just go quickly back to one thing Ingrid mentioned on the LCAs and the CO2 equivalent. Neither the EU nor the IMO addresses that right now. So even going regional on that aspect is not going to solve the problem. So we actually really need to get that right first. And it may be that the EU is more nimble and agile to get that right first, but it won't solve the issue if it's not done at IMO either. And if we look at the IMO, for all its negative aspects in terms of how long time it takes to decide things, if we look at the IMO 2020 sulfur rules, that shows that it can be done. It can actually ban a fuel and have a fundamental effect on shipping. I know we prepared, you were also part of that, prepared the IMO switchover for a while, and it took a long time, but we managed it, right? And it, without the chaos on the seas, as some were describing it, and I think that's very valuable. That doesn't mean that the EU doesn't have a role, because the EU is a fundamental block inside the IMO. So they are also pushing the IMO in the right direction and in the ambitious direction. So what we really need to have from our perspective is a clear timeline as to what is it that we want to achieve. And for us, we need a market-based measure, a framework for a market-based measure by 2025 at IMO level. We know that we have an ETS system coming up, and let's just assume that it can get adopted in 2023, which is when once it's gone through the political process, that's not completely unlikely. And you would then have 2023 to 2025, where we would have a period of time where you could run the EU emission trading system intra-EU, as is the case with aviation. But unlike aviation, we don't want it to run for a decade. We have a couple of years. We keep our seat at the table for EU member states at IMO. We enable them to continue to have these international negotiations. And if by 2025 the IMO hasn't delivered, then by all means the EU should then go to a full-scope ETS. And a full-scope ETS is the one that is based on the current reporting regulations that we have. And that means the last port before the European Union, intra-EU and first port out. So to make it very concrete, if you have a ship coming from Latin America, it would be all the way from Latin America to, say, Algeciras, and then Algeciras to Rotterdam, and then if it's then sailing from Rotterdam back to Algeciras and then out to the Emirates, that part as well. That's a substantial amount of extraterritoriality. But that can then happen should the IMO not be able to deliver.
Okay. Yeah. And you mentioned the market-based measures and so a carbon price, essentially, right, which will likely be necessary. And I think it's there have been some suggestions already, but I guess it's not, I mean, you can do a very rough calculation, right? If you assume that carbon neutral fuels are twice the price of bunker, I mean, it's probably not entirely off, at least in a while. And if you assume bunker at $450 and there are 3 tons of CO2 for each ton of fuel, then that becomes a necessary carbon tax of something like 150 US per ton, right? That's a significant price. Do you think that will ever fly with the EU or the IMO?
I think, you know, at EU level, the ETS system just crossed the 50 euros bar. And if shipping comes into the system, it's only going to go one way. So there, I think we're on the right track. Yes. When we look at IMO...
Yeah, prices are already well above 50, right?
Yes. Yeah. Well, when we look at the IMO, it's going to be a lot more complicated, for sure. So what we need to do is, of course, have a phase period in, right? But it can't be too long. So we have to keep that to a short amount of years and then phase it up to the prices that make sense to push these new fuels into the market. What we have to be careful about is that this doesn't become a tax on trade and there's no fuels to be put into that market. So that's why these two pathways have to be in parallel and then join up at some point within this decade, for sure. Right? And the last element to this is, of course, that when you look at IMO level, you have a number of developing nations, of least developed countries, of small island states, and we need to take their specific position into consideration. And you know, what we are trying to do with this carbon price, some of that levy or money or what it can be, needs specifically to go to these regions, because I think they can have a pretty fundamental role in this leap to the new fuels.
Yeah, because actually many of those countries are actually in regions of the world where renewable energy is very, very attractive, right? So that could very well be a role for them in the future fuel production. So definitely very important. I think we could go on on this, but I think maybe just to wrap it up here, I think so. Our point here is that to politicians that this is complex, but we do actually believe that with some simple principles, namely that you do everything based on life cycle assessments from well to wake, include all greenhouse gases, and remember to look at, given we are in an emergency, remember to look at the 20-year horizon. It will still be complex, but I think with that, that's at least our message, then we actually believe we can create a reasonable framework that will drive the right decision making and then accelerate our transition. And then, of course, I think, as we also concluded last time, this will be a collaboration with customers, with suppliers, with regulators, with other logistics companies. And I just want to stress that again, that this is not something anyone can do by themselves. But on that, I want to thank both of you for taking the time and sharing your insights, and we look forward to sharing more insights in coming webinars with you. Thank you.